Hello. Today I want to look at active effects. It's a fairly new feature that was introduced in version 0.7. I believe it's still a work in progress, as in more so than the rest of Foundry, to the point that the official knowledge base doesn't even mention them. So you probably don't want to rely on them just yet, and I don't know how long this video will remain up to date. But if you still want to try them out in your system, there's some work you need to do, and that's what we'll be looking at today. But first, let's explain what active effects are and how they work. The basic idea is that active effects allow you to alter an actor's stats on a temporary or conditional basis. For instance, let's say I have this ability called Untouchable, which doubles my character's armor class. With an active effect, I can turn this on and off and have the AC value change accordingly without needing to keep track of the previous value. Likewise, if I have a ring of strong that gives the wearer plus 25 in strength, the bonus will be applied automatically to the actor while in possession of the item. Though, as mentioned earlier, the system isn't very robust yet, so if you have several effects affecting the same stat, or if you have to make changes to a stat while an effect is active, unexpected results are to be expected. Nevertheless, this has a lot of potential, so it's worth investigating. You'll just have to keep an eye on release notes, because I can't guarantee I'll be revisiting this topic in a future video. So, how does one set up an active effect? Let's edit the Ring of Strong. In its Effects tab, I have a Strength plus 25 effect. If I go edit this effect, this brings up its configuration window. There we have three tabs. The Details tab is the admin stuff. Name, icon, and color, which doesn't seem to do anything. Then we have two tick boxes. Effect Suspended is what defines whether the effect has an effect. And transfer to actor, which is what makes the actor inherit the item's effect. This is on by default, though turning it off will render the effect useless, as you currently can't apply active effects to items. The second tab is about the effect's duration. If I understand correctly, this is supposed to have effects automatically wear off based on in-game time, or after a certain amount of rounds of combat. A bunch of code for it is there in core, but as far as I can tell, this feature is effectively non-functional at the time of recording this video, so I'm going to ignore that for now. The final tab is the list of effects, plural, because a single active effect can make several changes at once, so you can turn them all on or off at the same time. An effect is defined by three things: the key, which is which attribute you're going to change, the mode, which is how you're going to change it, and the value, whose meaning depends on the mode. The key is the path to the property as defined in the template.json, though since 0.8 you have to add data dot at the beginning. I expect this to change in a future update. While referring to attributes directly is super powerful, it's also not very user-friendly because it means you need to know about the system's data model to create effects. Though if we think that's an issue, we can always write our own active effect config window. Moving on to the mode, there are six ways to alter the property. Add will add the value to the attribute, as you'd expect. Likewise with multiply. Override is just as self-explanatory as the previous two. Upgrade is similar to override, but the change will only be applied if the target value is higher than the current value, while downgrade is the opposite. Finally, if you need to do anything more complex, Custom has an event you can hook onto, though that would be running the same code for every effect that uses the custom mode. But since Active Effect is a document, we can always write our own if we need to get fancier than that. Okay, now that the explanation is done, how would I implement active effects in Feng Shui? Once again with that kind of thing, it comes down to how much automation you want to do in your system. For Feng Shui, I'm going to do minimal service, limiting myself to stats alterations and supporting abilities that would render the existing automation useless if not accounted for. After examining the rules, I came up with a list of potential changes. While some of these are pretty situational, the simplest way to handle most of these cases without having to write complicated logic is to add them to the template.json. So, to the common actor template, I'll add a section I'll call bonuses and add properties corresponding to the various bonuses a character might get. Next, we need the ability to add active effects. In this system, active effects are mostly going to be coming from sticks, so I'll only need to modify that item sheet. First, we need to modify getData so that the sheet data contains the item's active effects, which we can do by calling the item's getEmbeddedCollection method, with the active effect parameter and getting the contents property of the result, which gives us an array of active effects. In the HBS template for the stick sheet, we need to add something to display that list. My implementation is going to be partially lifted from 5e, but I'll use a table rather than a list as it makes more sense to me. But that's not very important for the purpose of this video. I'll have one column for the effect name, I don't care about the icon, and one for the controls. I might add more columns later. The header for the second column will house the button that lets me add effects. Note the effect control class and the action data attribute to respectively bind and route the listener. For each effect, I'm adding a table row containing the name of the effect and control buttons for editing and deleting the effect. Note that, unlike 5e, I'm not adding a button for toggling the effect on or off, because this will be done directly from the character sheet. But before we get to that, let's finish writing the ability to add effects to sticks and add some for testing. In our custom item sheet class, where not much was happening, we're going to add a listener for the effect control selector. The same method will be used for all the operations on active effects for the sheet. In there, we grab the item and test the data attribute for the type of action. If the action is create, we create a new active effect with a default name and icon. We're also setting an origin parameter to the UUID of the item. We'll need this later. Finally, we're setting disable to true so that the effect is inactive by default. If we want to test our effect, we need to be able to edit it. So we'll grab the effect via its ID, which we had stored in the table row element, then add a case in the switch for the edit action, where we simply render the effects sheet. And to round things off, we can also set up the delete case for removing the effect. Now let's give this a try. As an example, I'll use the Justice Bringer shtick from our favorite character CJ, which gives her +2 on her gun stat in certain conditions. In the current version of Foundry, 0.8, you can't edit documents embedded in owned items. This means I can't add an effect on the shtick she already has. So I'll have to edit a standalone shtick and then replace that with the one she already has. I can click on the plus icon to create a new effect, then on the edit button to open the configuration window. I'll give the label a sensible name, then pop over to the effects tab and add a new change. Here I'm going to cheat for a moment. I know that CJ's gun stat is her primary attack stat. So in the attribute key, I'll put in data.attackPrimary.value, set the mode to add, and give an effect value of 2. We'll do something more robust later. For now, let's submit those changes. Now I can delete CJ's existing version of the stick and replace it with the one from the item directory. We can open the sheet for that item to confirm that the effect is there. Now I want to add a button to the stick card that will toggle the effect of the stick. In the stick card, I'll add a button on the title bar with a class called stickToggle. Similar to how it's done in 5e, I'll have the icon change depending on the status of the shtick. However, this active property doesn't exist anywhere in the template data. For simplicity, I'll add it to the template.json for shticks. In the code for the character sheet, I'll add another listener and callback for the shtick toggle selector. In there, we grab the shtick from its ID, as we usually do. And next, we need to retrieve the active effects from the actor, not the item. You see, when an active effect has transfer to actor set to true, what's actually happening is that the item's effects are copied to the actor, and it's those copies that actually affect the actor. There's no link between the copies beside the fact that it gets removed from the actor when it loses possession of the item. But what this means is that the actor's list of effects is a potential melting pot of effects from various sources. So to find the right effect to toggle, we need to filter this list. Active effects have an origin property which identifies the item it comes from. The string ends with what we passed as the origin of the effect when creating it. This means we can use that to filter the list and only keep the effects that originated from the shtick we clicked on. If the resulting list isn't empty, we flip the switch and use the new value to update both the shtick and all the relevant effects. Now if I go to CJ's sheet and click on the checkmark, we can see that our gun stat changes accordingly. And that's about it for the basic setup of active effects. But as I mentioned earlier, I cheated a bit when setting up the effect, and there's this user friendliness issue that I'd like to do something about. Solving both these problems means creating a custom config window for Active Effects. To do that, we create a new class which extends Active Effect config, override the template getter to point to our custom sheet, which we're going to copy from Foundry core, before going to the init hook and pointing config.activeEffect.sheet class to our newly created class. Now if you go over to that template we copied and scroll down to the end, we'll find the Effects tab, which is what I want to modify. Essentially, I want to replace the text field input for the key with a dropdown, similar to what we have below for the mode change. So we can actually copy that, remove the data attribute, since this is a string, and change the references to mode to be key instead. The question now is how to fill this dropdown. This Select Options Handlebars helper lets you create dropdown options from a dictionary, where the dictionary's key is the options value, and where the dictionary's value is the options label. So what we can do is build a dictionary that makes selecting changes more user-friendly, admittedly at the cost of less flexibility for the user. This is something we can do in our config.js file. I'll be creating an ActiveEffectChanges dictionary, where the key will be the attribute to change, and the value will be the path to a localized string for a human-readable label. You'll note that the last entries don't start with data. This is on purpose and will make sense later. We then need to make this dictionary available to the handlebars template. This is just like we did on the character sheet. We import the whole config dictionary and add it to the sheet data. In the effect config sheet, we can now point to that dictionary in the select options helper. Note the dot dot slash notation, because since we're inside the loop, we'll have to go one level up. We'll also have to add the localize equals true parameter to the select options helper so that it knows to fetch the correct text for the values. With that done, I can now create an effect change simply by choosing what I want to change without needing to know anything about the template. Okay, but I still haven't addressed the issue of having to know whether guns is the primary or backup attack stat. For that, we'll need to make our own version of Active Effect. You know the drill, new class, import it into the main file, and set config.activeEffect.document class. Next, we'll override the apply function so that we can intercept and process non-standard keys, which is how I'm going to solve this problem. In my effect changes dictionary, I've created a few entries that start with attack rather than data, and which correspond to the attack types available in this system. So in the apply function, I'll check if the key starts with attack. If it does, I'll check if the actor has it as either its primary or backup attack. If any of those is true, I'll replace the changes key with the appropriate attribute key before letting the parent function do its thing. Now, if I modify my active effect to affect the guns stat, we can see that it will find the correct value to override regardless of its location. And I think that's going to be it for today, as this video has gotten pretty long now. As mentioned, I have largely ignored temporary effects as it seems that the functionality isn't fully implemented yet. I do have a use case for them, but I'll probably wait a bit before looking into it. I've also not shown how to hook up all the bonus attributes I've created. But if you made it this far into the series, I expect it would be trivial to figure it out. It's just actor data, retrieve it and use it in the appropriate places. Note that at the time of recording, active effects can't alter the items they are attached to, only the actor owning said item, even though it looks like it should work. It shouldn't be too hard to write this functionality myself, but it's not critical to this system, so once again, I'll wait for a further update. See you next time. Bye.